Back with the start of the fifth turn, 15 a.m. For the sake of brevity and just not recording some of the stuff I've been doing in other turns, I went ahead and did all the initiative and weather rolls, and it's going to be clear, so that is probably now tilting towards the Soviet advantage because some of their reinforcements included three planes. So they got more air power, including this bad boy, a 1-6, which is very nice. So that means they're probably going to be able to use air power a lot easier and be able to get die roll modifiers in their favor, which is something they kind of need, although it's going to also help the Germans, obviously, because they still have their four planes doing very well. I also took the opportunity to give the Germans 5 victory points and acquire the activate any formation marker, which is funny, I'll explain in a second. I didn't get to use it this turn because when I rolled for initiative, this is what I got, 6 and a 5. And because the Germans had a +1 modifier from last turn for having a combat that let them advance 2 hexes, this became a 6, and the tie rules say that whoever had initiative the previous turn retains it. So that was kind of another setback for the Soviets in the sense that the Germans now, they got to put all 4 of their activation markers in, and the Soviets could only put in 5 of theirs. So, really torn. Obviously, you know, third tank, not really missing much there. But I had to basically choose not to have the activate any formation marker put in because I really did need to activate the 70th, the 237th, the 183rd, and the 21st tanks. Boop. Yeah. So I wanted to have activation any marker and it just didn't work out. What else do we get here? Let's see. Germans got only these for reinforcements. They got some more recon and 2 more armored cars for the motorized, 3rd motorized. So these are the units they should have had, hopefully you would have liked to have had in the beginning of the game because they allowed mobile attacks, but you know, better late than never. And the Soviets got a leader. Or a Shilov, I'm sorry, you know, the focusing here is not so great, and an NKVD unit, which is helpful in the sense that these can allow your units to instantly have, like, a no retreat. They can institute no retreats pretty easily. Okay, so yeah, let's see who starts, because Germans have the initiative. It's 15 a.m. Let's see. Third motorized. Okay. So that means we're going to be... See, this is kind of the unfortunate thing, right? Because now, as we can see here, we've got sort of stragglers of the third motorized are going to start coming up this road. And the real thing is that it's taken a couple turns to get everybody up here, but it's paid off now in the sense that here we are. So because of my overrun last turn, I was able to knock this unit back 2 hexes, and then I cause another one to have to retreat, and that's that hex that retreated. I'm sorry, that unit that had to retreat. And because I was able to stay in the zone of control or keep this in an enemy zone of control, it had to roll an ER check to lose disruption, had to beat a 5. It did not. So it stays disrupted. So it's probably going to be pretty easy to take that unit out and to keep rolling through, and Utrecht now is definitely under a lot of pressure. Germans just getting some very advantageous initiative rolls here. So I'm going to sit here and think about how the reinforcements are coming up. I'm going to still have to plan out my attack here, and once I do that, I'll come back and we'll check out the results of that. So this is the current disposition of the third motorized, and I sat here thinking about what I wanted to do, and I even contemplated if I had made a grievous error on the Soviets by being a little aggressive and attacking up here to cause a step loss on one of these motorized infantries. Because as you can see now, the third motorized have sort of busted a hole through here through overrun and combats, and now they have a nice line of troops that they can overrun up here, including a stack that was disrupted last turn, but because it wasn't an enemy zone of control during the reorganization phase, it had to pass an ER check to lose disruption, and it did not. And that's kind of bad for it because disruption lowers your efficiency rating and it's going to make it even more vulnerable to attacks and overruns. And so I kind of sat there and thought, oh man, have I really compromised the Soviet position, because if you take a look down the line, there's just not much after this stack here, which is really just an HQ, an engineering unit, and some artillery. There's victory point hex, there's victory point hex, there's one, there's not much here, right? I've got some reinforcements coming up here, and I sort of cheated because I originally wanted them to come down here, and then after looking at the board and realizing what a precarious situation the third had put the 237 in up here, I quickly realized, oh, I better ship those reinforcements to the north, because if the third motorized breaks through here, they're going to have pretty much a pretty easy path to score some major victory hexes, and the 70th is too far committed to the south to really react properly. Well, I thought that for a second, and honestly, it's not great for the Soviets, but it's not as bad as I once thought. The attack I want to pull off here is going to be kind of tricky, and I think I'm going to go over and show you what I want to do. So I have some reinforcements that are moving their way up the line. The question is, how do I properly get them into place, because they're kind of scattered and it's all rough terrain. So what I'm thinking is this. My idea is to take this unit, because it has the tank unit, like what I said before. Oh, I need to flip this HQ over. There it is, this tank guy. He's probably like the most valuable unit, I feel like, almost in the game, for the 3rd Motorized especially, because it's a zero stack unit, and it's armor, so it allows mobile attacks. It's the only unit for them that does allow that. So this stack here, which has a shrink rate of 18, is going to just overrun this hex, and then because it's in the zone of control of this hex, when it overruns that one, it's going to have to overrun that one as well, or stop moving. And my plan is basically to overrun this, come up here, have this stack, which is 2 reduced motorized infantries. They're going to come up here, I should say, 2 reduced motorized infantry battalions. They're going to come up here, and they're going to conduct an attack up here. Hopefully try and dislodge the 237 HQ, hopefully maybe destroy it or damage it, and mainly knock them out of the road. Doing so will allow me to cut this unit off from supply. This stack will be out of supply. Will it be? That's not entirely true. It actually, because infantry units can use trails pretty effectively for supply, so it's hard to cut them off, but it will put them in a pickle, put them in a bad spot. The only concern I have, of course, is that I don't know what to do with this stack, because this stack, I'm going to be taking these 2 units away, and this is not a really powerful stack here. This is just an anti-tank and artillery, pretty vulnerable. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull these guys back, I think to Gorodishche, because what I'm going to do is bring these motorcycle infantry, and they're going to get pretty close to Gorodishche, but not close enough. I think they can get to here, and what will happen is I'll act as kind of a stopgap here. So if this unit kind of wants to come down, it won't be able to go too far down the line and kind of stay down here and cut off my supply. But I can also have combat reaction units that can move up here if he gets attacked. I can try to roll and get them to operate, and that's pretty likely because they have a 7 ER rating. So they're going to come over here and help that out. I'm going to take this motorized infantry, and it's going to join this artillery in the ARCO HQ here, in this town of Kaminka, and then I'm going to take this artillery unit, and it's going to kind of sneak up here and join up with the motorized infantry and these guys to act as sort of the pushing back force, because I'm not really sure the 237 unit's even going to try to go this way. It might if it feels brave, but it might also be trying to pull back. We'll just have to see what happens with this attack, and then kind of judge accordingly from there. So let's go ahead and get some of these other units moved. So what I'm going to do is move this guy back. He has, what, 5 and 5, 0, and 1, and 2. And this guy is going to go 1, and 2, and 3, and 4, 5, 6, 7. This guy's going to go 1, 2, wait, I'm sorry, where was he? He was here, my bad. He's actually going to go and 1, 2, and 3, 4, and, perfect. And then, of course, we're going to take this guy's, and he's just going to go boop, boop. He can easily make that. This guy's going to go 1, 2, and 3, and 4, and 5, and. All right. So now we can get a little closer. Sorry. Just in the camera. Now we can get a little closer on the action as what's really going to happen here. So to finish off the rest of my moves, we're going to do an overrun combat from this hex to that hex. These guys are battalions of the 237. We've got a 5-4, a 5-4, and then a reduced 2-2-4. So you can see right now that their highest rating is a 5, but because they're disrupted, it's going to make it actually a 3 because you get a minus 2 ER with your disruption. So let's go ahead and run through this combat. So we have, what do we got then? It's 18 to 10, so it's going to be good enough for 3 to 2 odds. Not great, but for overrun, I think it's going to be okay for what we're trying to do here. I can use a plane, and because it's clear, this combat I'm not going to worry about it because they're already disrupted and I don't need the modifier, so I'm not going to bring my close air support in. The Germans, or Soviets, cannot use close air support during overrun. Germans can use one close air support. Artillery, you actually can't use artillery unless there's one already in the hex. This is a big reason why I'm doing overrun, because there is some artillery stacked under here that's fairly powerful. There's a 6, there's a 4. So I think I made a mistake last turn not using my artillery to defend some of these attacks. That could have been a huge mistake. That happens. You make those, right? So, we got 3-2, they can't use artillery, we're not going to use planes, and we don't need to do a combat coordination check because I'm only attacking from one hex, and it's a mobile combat, and they're all from the same formation. So let's go ahead and do our odds breakdowns. There's no defensive terrain here for me to utilize for an overrun. So we just break down ER, I'm going to be using, not that guy, I'm going to be using that guy, a 6 for my lead unit. We know he has a 5, but it's minus 2, so it's a 3 bonus in my favor. So I get minus 3 ER. I get a minus 1 combined arms bonus because I'm attacking with both armor and motorized. And he doesn't get any defensive terrain or any other kind of shifts, so it's a minus 4 to the roll. So 3 to 2 with a minus 4. We're going to take our tie. Got a 5. So that's a 1 on the 3 to 2 odds for mobile combat, and that's a defender 1 retreat. So this guy takes a step loss. And he has to go back 2 hexes any way that we desire. But he can't go through, he has some restrictions. I can't make him go through enemy zones of control. So I think what we're going to do is we're actually going to just gum up the works here. We're just going to go 1-2. We're just going to keep these guys on the road. He's already been disrupted, so he does that. So that attack cost us 2 movement, 1 to enter a clear hex, 1 for the overrun. So now we're here in this hex, and we have to either stop moving or overrun that hex because it projects a zone of control. I'm going to keep overrunning. So basically, a lot of these calculations are going to be the same, except we might actually use air power this time. This stack, I believe, is still a 10. That's a 4, an 8, and a 2. That's a 10. So I have 18 and 10, so we have the same odds, 3 to 2. I will be using my... this guy again is my lead unit at 6, and I believe they only have 4s. Yeah. So I only get a minus 2 ER differential this time. And because of that, I think, do I want to use a plane on this? Probably should, but yeah, let's go ahead and use a plane. Let's go ahead and try to get a plane in the game. So I got to roll a 5 or lower, or it's plus 1 because of mobile combat. I won't spend points on this. All right, got that plane. So that's minus 2 ER, minus 1 combined arms bonus, minus 1 close air assault. So that gives us back our minus 4. Again, this Soviet unit has no artillery, it can't use that because I'm overrunning it, it can't use close air support, and we don't have to do a combat coordination check. So we've got minus 4, that's a really gross looking 4, but it is a 4, I think I got kind of part of it erased. That's a minus 4 to the roll, again, 3 to 2 combat, so let's get a roll. Alright, we get a 5 again, so that's a defender 1 retreat. That guy will eat it. And actually, we're going to have him just go 1, 2. We're just going to have him hide out over there. Okay, so that was another 2 movements. That's 4 movement total. And I could overrun. I think I can overrun this guy again because he's right there. I wonder if I should have put him there. He was what? I was here, he was here, and I made him go 1, 2. Yeah, I don't think there's anywhere I could have put him where he wouldn't have gotten overrun again. So we're going to overrun one more time. This time we're not going to use a plane, so we won't get close to our support. But we know our ER differential is going to be -3 again. This time he's actually in defensible terrain. He's in a forest. So he gets a +2 because he's in a forest. So now our roll is just a -2. So this could be a little bit more risky because might not get good rolls. We're going to press our luck though. Man, we really did a good job pressing our luck. So it's a 3 with -2. That's another 1 on a 3-2 odds. Well, it was 3. Was it 3-2 odds or did we get better odds this time? Is that 4-8? Uh-oh. I got better than odds because there's only 8 things here and I have 18. So I had 2-1. I got a 1 on a 2-1. Oh, no, that's kind of crummy. Attacker 1, defender 2, retreat. That's really crummy. Yep, that's super, super crummy. So that guy goes down. Defender 2, retreat. Alright, so that was his lead unit. That guy gets vaporized, and he'll just go ahead and die. So that's their 2. They lose, and they have to retreat. And we'll go ahead and just move them and go 1, 2. All the movement this guy could muster for that. Losing a step was kind of annoying. And it was armor attrition, too. Oh, shoot. Oh, we're good. Alright. So that's kind of annoying, but I wanted to get up to this unit because I want to be able to attack it when I bring these guys up. And so these guys are going to go and 1, 2, 3. They're going to stop. And then we'll do another attack right there. Okay, so now we can calculate this attack. So let's go ahead and erase my previous calculations. All right, so now this time what do we have? I know the smaller stack is an 8. This guy got reduced, so let's see what we got here. We got a 2, got an 8. So we got a 4, 5, 6, 12, 17. So 17 plus 8 is 25, right? Yep. So that's 25. And what's it going to be against? This guy will fire. So 3, 6, 7, 8. 8 plus 6 is 14. Will I be able to reach him with my artillery? 5. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oh, it's just too far. Just too far. And he could probably call in some defense. It is going to be a mobile attack, but I won't be able to get, what do we say he has? Oh, yeah. 3, 6, 7. Ooh, I'm so sorry, I just counted this, not going to count in. 3, 6, 7, 8, and that, so I'll make it 14. So he potentially could have 14. Five, 4, and 7 would be 6. So I have 3-2 odds again here, which is not amazing, but, you know, maybe we'll take that. Just because this could be a good opportunity, so let's press our luck. Sadly, we don't have artillery support. He has no units that can combat react. He can't retreat, But because his HQ unit's there, he can do a no-retreat attempt. And I think he will try to do that. Because he doesn't want to retreat at all. So let's double-check that. Yep. And because it's non-disrupted HQ, he automatically passes the check. The no-retreat check, which is very nice for him. All right, where's my no-retreat for... So he gets a no retreat. We'll just keep that up there and let you know. Let's see. I am going to bring in close air support. I think he is as well. So he's going to bring in a plane. I'm going to bring in a plane. And I'm going to spend command points to try to get this plane in because I think we're going to need this to succeed. He will spend a command point as well. So essentially he has to roll... 5 or less, and I have to roll a 6 or less. Oh, we both got it. That's weird. There's a 5 for them. 2 for me, so that offsets that. And we don't have any artillery that can reach it because my units are too far away. He has artillery. So the way it works is when you have artillery defending a stack, if it's just artillery, you're kind of screwed because they have to defend with their defense value. But... if you have more than one, you have other defense units, like we have this anti-tank and this engineer, then I can use one of these guys as for their support strength in this attack. That's why they get 14 defense points, because I'm going to use that. Otherwise, they would have, what, like 9? It wouldn't be very much. So he gets that as a temporary boost there because he can defend himself, and he does have to coordinate because it's automatically in his hex. So that's one nice advantage, too. If you're in attacking... your hex you're attacking from or into, they both can have one automatic coordination of artillery. So we did that. He did his little no retreat. So let's see, I'm a little slow today. So we're running through combat. We did that, got that. We need to do a combat coordination check because I am attacking from more than one hex, even though they're all the same formation. So my lead unit will be that guy. We'll make him the lead unit. Let's make that guy, because he's worth less. So we just have to beat, and I will use 2 points here as well. So I've got to beat, so it's a 6 with a minus two plus one. If it's mobile, -2 for command points, so overall -1. All right, I get it. So I'm combat coordinated, we've done all our checks, he has no retreats, let's do our final calculations of DRMs. My efficiency rating I think is going to be better because I have 6, and the only unit he's going to defend with, I believe, is the... he's got the engineer, so he'll defend with the engineer, so no ER differential. He gets +1 for no retreat. I get -1 for combined arms bonus. Yeah, so this is going to be a lot risky. This is going to be a pretty risky attack, actually. Could really suffer bad here. But we're taking advantage of it. And we're making use of artillery, which is definitely valuable in its own right. So you got to take sometimes risky attacks, and you got to just do this. Okay, so here we go. Okay, getting good rolls again. A 2. That's very good for me, because this was a risky attack. So 3-2. Mobile. 2 result is defender 1 retreat. That's big time. So what we'll do is we'll take this guy. And so the engineering unit was the lead guy. He gets flipped. And they have to retreat 2 hexes. So we'll go... Oh, they can retreat because he put in no retreat. So he actually suffers another step loss. That's my bad. It's going to have to come from this... Yeah, the anti-tank unit's going to take it. That's a very surprising 2-step anti-tank unit. So we didn't make him retreat, and that actually stays on for the entire turn. We can't get rid of it, but it stays on there. So he took an additional loss because of the no retreat, because when you don't retreat, you have to take additional step losses. And so he took loss 2, so that's pretty good. Use the artillery, lost 2 steps. Very risky attacks, but they paid off there big time for the Germans. All right, so let's see who's going to be up next for the Soviets. 21st Tanks. So when we come back, we'll take a look and see what the 21st Tanks are going to do. So as I shut the camera down and was thinking about what I just did, I realized this tack was on a village, so it should have gotten a +1 die roll modifier here. I checked the results. What that would have been was a defender retreat and not a defender 1 retreat. So I went ahead and gave them back their step loss to the anti-tank unit. They still suffer a step loss because of the no retreat marker they went for. So it was a minor error, you know. Still a good attack though, still good. So I just wanted to correct that before I move on to the 21st tanks. So a funny thing happened. After I recorded the last turn and then did that correction you just saw, I got a phone call to go help a buddy. He needed help moving a couch. So as I was driving there, I was thinking about the turn I just had and about all the overruns that I had just accomplished. And you know, that'd been a first for me doing that many overruns. And so I was kind of thinking, I made sure I was doing it all right and got the procedure. And then it occurred to me, as you can see here with the scrawl I wrote down here, I gave back 2 steps this unit because I did an illegal overrun. And that illegal overrun was here in this forest hex. I did the previous 2 overruns correctly. In fact, we'll turn the camera just a little bit. I did the previous 2 correctly from here. You know, this cost me 2 movement, this cost me 2 movement. This would have cost me 3 additional movement because it was a forest hex, and I gave the defender the forest hex Bennett bonus for overrun, the defensive bonus they get, but it didn't occur to me to actually treat it as real terrain. I gave it as defensive terrain and not real terrain. You know, that was kind of a big mistake. That was a big mistake. So I didn't want to just go back and like recreate the battle and do that. That was gonna be a lot of bookkeeping work in doing that. So my compromise solution is to give back the unit that did get pushed back 2 steps, which so gives it back 1 full strength unit and brought back a unit from the dead. It's not a great compromise, but at the same time, I'm less worried about the Germans making a general breakthrough now, because as I look at the map, even though that is pretty open in the back, there's still units here, and there's only 1 more activation that their motorized can get. So at best, they might be able to push this stack aside, but they still can't get past these guys and these guys here. So I'm less worried about that now. I was really worried about it, and then even though I messed up those overruns, getting back the 2 steps I feel will help rectify that mistake. It's not perfect. It's the first big mistake I made. I probably should have stopped and thought about the overruns a little more, but, you know, I went with it, and that's what happens. So, you know, whatever, that happens. So I made the mistake, you know, I made the correction. I did that. Judgment call. So we're going to erase that. This is why I like Plexi. I get to write on here, get to make little notes. Like Bob Ross, I can draw happy trees. It's really nice. Okay. So as you remember, I drew the 21st tanks chit. So here's my thought. I might actually pass. This is crazy, because I really don't want to give the Germans a lot of initiative, as they already have won every initiative battle and have been dictating the tempo and pace of this scenario so far. But the 21st tanks are not a real great point unit to launch. As you remember, we have these guys here, and their goal is to come up here and become a cut threat, hopefully over here. I could move them in position, that'd be great. But part of the other thing I want to do is I want to use the 21st tanks up there. If you recall, I put those guys up there. They're a very powerful stack here. It's 6, it's a 12, was it 17? That's a powerful stack, and they're all red box movement. This is a very versatile, powerful Soviet unit. Unfortunately, if I just move it on its own to do something, it's going to be totally surrounded and killed by the 8th Panzer. Because I won't be able to activate them again. And it's unlikely I'll probably, I mean, I might get the 70th before they draw an 8th Panzer once or maybe twice, but I don't want to risk it because this is already a high value target for the Germans. It has 2 armor steps. That's big time. Or it has 2 armor units, which equals a lot of VP if I kill it. That's super big time. Yeah. So even though I don't want to pass, because what does passing do? Well, passing allows me to, perhaps in the future, use combined formation, which is kind of the only bonus of this idea, is that essentially, in the future, if I drew the 70th, then I would be able to potentially carry out a combined formation role, and if I pass that role, and I can use my leader to get a DRM for that, if I pass that role, then I can use both formations in 1 turn. There are some restrictions. I for example, can't attack. I think there's some attack restrictions. If it happens, we'll go over it. I don't want to quote it without looking at the rules right now. But it's where I can get all those units to move. The downside to it is that I give my opponent a +1 DRM for their initiative roll on the next turn, because literally I'm just sort of gathering my forces and time and planning and giving them the ability to exploit. But passing is a good idea, I think, because like I said, I'm less worried about the third motorized up in the north. I don't think they're really going to get the huge breakthrough I was fearing in the beginning. I mean, they're going to do a lot of damage. But I think I'm going to be able to get my reinforcements of the 202, which you can just barely not see. There we go. I think they're going to be able to come up here and reinforce this part sufficiently and in time, so I'm not worried about losing too many victory points, although I'm pretty... It's not great. In my last game, I didn't lose this hex, and I'm going to. Yeah, it's going to be interesting. So I think I am going to pass. So we're going to pass. We're going to give them a +1. So normally, if we were playing, if I was playing face-to-face with somebody and I got this, they wouldn't know I drew the 21st. You actually keep it secret. And then if I wanted to pass, I would just turn it down and put in the activation marker. They would just see this. And the next turn, if I draw a chit, I can decide to either use that chit or use this chit, or I can do a combined formation. And if I use this chit, then the other one has to become the new holding chit. And you eventually have to use all your chits. You can't just have a chit sitting there and then never get used. So I'm going to pass, and what we're going to do actually is, because this is the first time we've actually done that, is keep it especially in the box up there on its own. Okay. Time for the... Alright, what is it? Da-da-da-da. Eighth Panzer. Wait, oops, don't put that in the cup again. Alright, so let's get down in the nitty-gritty here. I'm going to start contemplating what's got to be done. So, this is the situation right now. We're holding Soltsy. We have a few reserves in the back, which are off-camera, which is just essentially three tank units and an artillery unit that's a battalion of five support strength. And we also have to be wary of the 183rd, which is a cut threat. And they actually can... Let's see if I can get the ultra-wide view. Not super descriptive, but they're on the edges here. So we see the 183rd as a cut threat, and they can come up here. And I need to kind of keep some forces in the back to act as a reactive force, so that when they make their move, I can either reestablish supply by occupying the hex to reestablish it by force, or knock them off the road, or knock them back. So what we'll probably do is just keep these tanks here, unless I can think of a good reason to use them in the battle up here, or what I want to do, because of course we're holding Soltsy. So I have some options. I can sort of strike out. I don't really want to give up these hexes, but I do have some forces to play with back here. I could use an assault turn and start building strong points and then kind of bait them into attacking me, which I think they're going to try to do anyway. But if I can even get one on this hex, which is the victory point hex, a strong point, it's going to greatly enhance my ability to defend that hex with less forces, so that I can actually get more on the reactive force and keep the road open, because that's going to be really the key here for this force. So I'm going to take a break. I'm going to think about what I want to do with the 8th Panzer, and when I come back, we'll decide what kind of attacks, if any, we want to execute, or if we want to do an assault turn. Back with the 8th Panzer, and looking at the situation, I've discovered a couple, well, I may have known, but I rediscovered, because it's been a day or so since I've looked. But this is a really defensive stack here. This has got three of those guys, who are all one stacking unit, and so that's six defense right there. And they are teamed up with the leader, who doesn't really count, the HQ we will keep, that's 1 point. But then two motorized infantry worth seven each. So we're talking 14 plus 6, 20, 21 defense in that hex alone. Wow. So I think that hex is going to just chill. And I thought I was going to do an assault turn and build a strong point there. But I think instead what I'm going to do is take advantage of the fact that the 21st tanks have passed, and I think I'm going to strike at their tank unit up here. I mean, that was kind of the problem, right? The 21st tanks could have acted, but... You know, they didn't have great options, they didn't have good support, and didn't have good targets. Now they're going to be the target. And it's sort of unfortunate, but we'll see what ultimately happens. And, you know, it's sort of the cost. That's sort of the problem with the Soviets, right? They just didn't have good coordination. And ultimately, I drew them at the most inopportune time. I really hoped the 70th would go first, but they didn't. So what instead I'm going to do is I'm going to take this unit here. And the other thought I thought about was the cut threat. I'm going to take some forces and divert them down there to begin my reaction force. But I think I'm going to take my powerful forces and start striking up here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this HQ, and he has two motorized infantry with him that are powerful as well. What's going to happen is they're going to go and 1, 2, 3, 4. Oops, as I flipped those guys over. All right, so he's put himself in a marsh hex, so even if he gets attacked, if artillery is used, it won't be as effective. That's very handy. He's going to be joined, because he only has 6 points there. He's going to be joined by a tank from here. So that tank's going to go 1, 2, 3, 4, and join him there. All right. And then the final unit to join up there will be this guy, this rocket unit. He's great. He's 5 attack. He's a red box unit, so he can advance after combat. Very nice. He only gets used once because he gets spent after using, but still a very powerful unit. So he's going to go 1. Wait, how is he actually going to do that? Hold on a second. I'm going to have him getting up there. Oh. And 1, 2, and yeah, that's what it was. That's how, I mean, he can get up there. I just want to make sure, because sometimes with the zone of control and everything, you got to be double sure. All right. So he left, and because he left, that opens up this spot here. What I'm going to do here, though, is that this hex is kind of weakly defended with a lot of spent armor and just that supple-barreled anti-tank unit. So I'm going to take this guy, and he's going to come over here and help reinforce this stack, just in case they get thoughts of attacking it. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this armored car, these two armored cars, and this tank unit, and this motorcycle infantry, and we're actually going to come down here, and they're going to form the first elements of the reaction force. So we're going to actually have them join up and probably cover this unit here if they can, so it won't be like sniped. I don't think they really can be, but this is an okay place to be, because they can still go pretty far around the range of where these units can possibly move. So we'll go and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So yeah, he can make it. 7 and 6. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So actually we'll just stop there. And that actually is not so bad. It's a good defense, I think, a good defensive line. Okay, so we can react to attacks by the 183rd, and we'll deal with that later. So there's some forces on hold there waiting. But meanwhile, we'll come back up here, and then to finish off what we're doing, I'm going to pull this artillery back over here. So that's what, 2, 4, 6. I think what we'll do is we'll actually take this guy. He's going to come help defend this stack, because I don't like leaving artillery just all the way alone. And then this guy's actually just going to hang out. We'll just go one more back. So I think that's far enough away from the 21st tanks that they couldn't plausibly get there easily. Yeah, I think that's pretty far away. I'm not going to check it because that's a little too anal. I'm just going to go with my gut here. So the big thing is we're going to do an attack here. So what do we have? We have 5 attacking. We have 6, 12, so that's 17 so far, 20. This guy I know has 10. I counted that before. Sorry, I did a little of that magical, you know, when they do cooking shows and some things are just done, I did a little magical odds calculation earlier. So we have 20 to 10. So we got 2 to 1. He can react and move. And he's actually going to try to run away, because obviously he doesn't want to stay there and take this battle. And it's not going to help him have a no retreat, I don't think, and there's nobody that can help him out. So I think he is going to try to do a combat refusal.
They all are red box and none of them disrupted. So we're going to do an ER check on the lead unit, and there's a guy with a 5 value there. So we're going to have to try to beat a 5. Oh my goodness, we actually do. We get a 4. Alright. So because we succeeded, we get to... Dun, dun, dun. Retreat 2 hexes. Okay. And I think he's just going to go 1, 2. He's going to hang on that city. And, or he actually will go, well, yeah, we'll just keep him across there. We'll keep him there. Now, I can't advance after combat. I can actually advance 2 hexes because he did retreat. But I don't know if I want to because I could still get to him if I need to. And I don't want to get too far away from the rest of the 8th Panzer. I want to be able to react if something happens down here. And I could get swarmed here, but he's pretty defensive as well. That guy was... Actually, he didn't get used. I'm going to have to check the rules to see if he gets used, because that combat didn't occur because of the refusal. But I mean, there's 7, 14, 16, 17, 18. So there's 18 defense factors there. I'm not too worried about them. So that's the 8th Panzer's move. Just kind of fortifying, moving some guys back, thinking about that. So let's see who's up next for the Soviets. The 237th. So this is not someone I want to combine activate with the 21st tanks, because I want to wait for the 70th for that. So I think we are just going to use the 237th, and they're going to be up. And the 237th, of course, is the units that are fending off brutal attacks by the 3rd Motorized, so it's good that they're actually going to get activated. We can get our defense together there at that point. So this is good news for the Soviets. So when I come back, we'll actually be fortifying... what is that town? Utrugorsh, of course. I just remembered it's right there. Utrugorsh. So when I come back, we'll talk about that. Here is the position of the 237th. So we have the stack over here that we thought might be a good cut risk, but because the 3rd Motorized has put some units over there at Gorodishche and defended it, it's not going to be a viable... I mean, they're cutting supply right now, which is handy, in a sense. I'm talking this out, and I'm thinking maybe it is a good thing that they're just kind of chilling there and blocking supply. The main thing I want to talk about is up here. So we know that we have a couple artillery units, this weakened engineer unit, and also an anti-tank unit. So what I think we're going to do is we're going to play a little swap. And we're going to take out the artillery unit that has already fired, and in its place, we're going to put in this full-strength but disrupted infantry battalion, because it has 4 defense, and disruption, even though it's not great for your ER rating or movement, does not affect your defense. So we can put them in there, get more defense in that hex, pull that artillery out, and put it in a safer place, hopefully. The other thing we can do is move this stack. It is disrupted, so it loses 2 movement, which gives them only 2 total movement. And so I think what we're going to do is just go 1, 2, and put them there. That way, when the reorganization, unless the 3rd Motorized gets up on them during reorganization phase, that disruption marker will automatically go away. If they're in an enemy zone of control, then you do an ER check. But here, hopefully, they'll be safe and not pressed upon, and they can get out of their disruption at the reorganization phase. So we look at this unit and we say, okay, I thought about doing an assault and trying to build a strong point here, but I know they're just going to attack. And if you try to build a strong point and they attack, it negates the strong point. I don't know what I'm going to do with these units. And thinking about them cutting is kind of an interesting holdout option. They would be out of supply themselves, but it would be a nuisance for the 3rd Motorized to deal with, and it might buy them time. Because honestly, like, these units alone probably can't deal with them. They're going to need help from these guys, and to pull them back is very helpful, and maybe even divert forces from here. So this is kind of where we think maybe we sacrifice units, which sounds terrible, but to put them in a position where they can actually do a lot of damage, just buying time, you know, buying time for attacks. That's very interesting. I can't believe I didn't really think about that before. I've been sitting here looking at these pieces for about 10 minutes, and that really didn't even hit me, and now I'm talking it out, and it just occurs that, oh, yeah, you should do that. Well, that's probably a good idea. Okay, so we'll probably do that. Let's focus on what we're going to actually move up here. All right, let's focus. There we go. So what I'm going to do is I moved those guys already, so I'm going to take this used artillery. We'll just put him over here for now because I'm going to decide what I'm going to do with him. And then I'm going to take this full-strength battalion. I'm going to put him at the bottom of the stack just because he's disrupted, and it'll just be easier to remember that the most bottom unit is the one that's the disrupted one. He'll go here and he'll stay here because honestly, these guys are disrupted. Anyway, I have to find a new marker. Oh, wait. There we go. Boom. He'll actually chill out here because I really doubt that the third motorized, because I can get a no retreat result if I want because the HQ is still there. I kind of doubt that the third motorized is going to be able to really move that unit there. We'll see. I could pay for this, but I feel like this is a pretty safe move in terms of defense, and I'm a lot less worried about the breakthrough that I thought at the beginning of the turn would happen. And I still haven't seen the 202 happen, but they'll be able to bring their units and reinforce this X over here, which is Medved. All right. So now the question is, what to do with these guys? I have one unit hanging out here, and he's with a bunch of the third tanks that we just haven't drawn for turns, because this is pretty much all that's left of the third tanks. You know, because I didn't do a lot of movement up here, although this will have their movement, so maybe I'll just go there. I think we will just do an assault turn. And what we'll do is we'll declare this an assault turn. So this guy actually was, what, here? So if we do an assault turn, that lowers our MA, our movement allowance, by half. So this guy already had two because he's disrupted, and it's now one. So we can go there, and that's fine. This guy was okay to do what he did, and he was okay to go here because... he could still get here with two, because if he was here, it would cost and then one for entering there, so one and this guy could go there for a half movement. We haven't moved these guys yet, and because I haven't moved this guy, and he's sitting here, and he's an infantry unit, he can actually begin building a strong point. So let's build a strong point there. So, begin building one there. And then these guys will have half movement, and what we'll do is we'll just begin moving them on the road, and I wish there was a city we could actually go hold this city. You know, that might not be a half bad idea. It's really close to here, though. I don't know how good that is. We could go here, so let's do that. That's one, and two, and. It's a little off camera there, sorry. So here's the thing. I put them here now, and now they're going to be a total pain. And I thought about moving these guys here, but I wanted them to be close enough so that these units, because this is as far as these motorcycle infantry could go, I was really worried they couldn't react move, and now I'm kind of paying for that caution, because I kind of just wanted to put them here. They wouldn't be close enough for these guys to help them out in case they got attacked, which they could have easily been attacked by these guys. And they only have four defense, or actually they would have had six, but... these guys are 12, so it would have been a 2-1, kind of risky. Well, now we're going to see what happens here, because these units, you know, they're going to suicide out here, because I could not get them back to any kind of satisfactory place over here. Like, I was looking at the movement where they could go, and there was just no, I mean, the best they could do was, like, here, or here, or around here. They just couldn't really get around here, so it's like, okay, we'll just suicide out here and hopefully buy some time. And it really is going to be a pain for the Germans to deal with. and the strong point here if it gets built. We'll see if it lasts, because it has to be in supply, but that could be a very annoying point of resistance as well. Okay, so let's see who goes next for the Soviets. All right, so the Germans. Oops, sorry.
Third motorized.
Okay, so now we're really going to have to think about what we want to do here, because obviously this attack is pressing, but they've been able to shift in new defenders, so the odds are going to be a lot not as favorable as we want. We also have this question of, what are we going to do about this unit over here? And should we react with our one motorized here with our infantry? We don't really have enough here to do it, and we also have an artillery off camera, which you can't see. Oh, there he is. So he's over here. So should he help out as well? Lots to think about. So I'm going to take a break, and then when I come back, we'll actually move the third motorized. So this is the situation the third motorized is facing for their last activation on this turn. While they had some good successes over here, knocking units back, even though there was an illegal overrun, this unit slipped over. It actually got the perfect activation, the 237th having coming just before the 3rd Motorized activated. That was kind of perfect timing for the Soviets. They were able to both consolidate the position up here, which made them a lot tougher to crack, and they also were able to take this unit and surge down here and become quite a nuisance, because it is a 12 stack and it is sitting on my supply route. So now I have to consider, I wanted to kind of attack this point again with these units, or even bring up this motorized and have even more greater damage be brought. Unfortunately, I think that just can't happen, because I don't have enough forces from here or here, and the reinforcements coming up won't quite make it. There just won't be enough to tackle this, because it would just be assault combat without this the tank unit that this stack possesses. Because I made a mistake earlier, I said that unit's the only one the third motorized has that allows mobile combat, but actually they have two armored cars. They just come in really late in the game, and they're part of the last bit of the reinforcements the third motorized gets. So by the time the cars come up, we'll have much greater mobile attack capability. But until then, it's a lot of assault combats, and 12 steps is enough to be difficult. I don't really want to do a 2-to-1 assault. You just take a lot more losses that way. I'd rather get a 2-to-1 mobile, or 3-to-1 is what we're going to try to do. So here's how it's going to bring. We're going to bring up the reinforcements first. So we got two armor cars and reconnaissance units. It's going to be, you can't see it off camera, but I'm moving, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. And that means this guy would go down there. Okay. Just CC I brought up. I brought up these two armored cars. And also this reconnaissance unit. So once these armored cars get in the game, I mean, it'll be a lot nicer, because I'll actually be able to let units engage in mobile combat, which is something the third motorized, because of the way the reinforcements come in, it makes them a slightly less potent force. I mean, they have a lot of motorized infantry, they're very powerful grouped together, but without their tank unit or without their armored cars, they just don't have the ability to conduct mobile attacks, and it really hamstrings their ability to attack fortified Soviet positions or just even large Soviet stacks. Okay, so the other thing we're going to do, let's get a little closer. So I'm going to bring in some of these units. There we go. Let's see if I can get this light to be a little better. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring in some of these units to come up here. And actually what this is going to be these two motorcycle infantry. You're going to go and 1, 2, 3. And we're going to bring this guy up. And we're going to bring this artillery up. And there's actually an artillery down here we're going to bring up as well. 1, 2, 3, and 4. Yeah, we'll go ahead and keep him there, I guess. He can just hang out here. Why not? So they'll be that way. And then we'll be bringing over... Let's see if I can get this out. I'm already maxed out. Alright. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to be taking this stack, but I'm going to drop off this guy and just leave him behind. So I'm going to take that tank, the motorized is powerful, another powerful motorized, And they're going to zoom down the road. And they're going to go, and one, and two, and three, and four, and this guy remains there. These units are going to slide over here. And keep pressure here, because there is one unit that's still disrupted, and as long as we keep an enemy zone of control, it may not pass its check and thus stay disrupted. And then the other thing we're going to do is we're going to bring in these guys. And this is, you remember this motorized, he's sitting on top of the special Arco HQ that helps our artillery, and also has sort of other artillery units behind it. We have a lot of artillery for the third motorized, which is very nice. So this guy's going to join his compatriots up there. He's going to go and... Actually, he's going to go 1, 2, and 3, and 4, and 5, and... And what I think we'll do with these artillery units is bring them up as well. So they can go... What are they, LF5? Yeah, LF5. So it's going to be... 1, 2, and 3, and 4, and we'll keep them there. That makes them a little safer. Hopefully. We'll see what happens to the stack. It could actually, well, hopefully it won't retreat up here. I guess it could. That would be kind of not so great, but that's okay. I'll stay in the village. It gives me at least some defensive cover. Okay, so I think we've done it. We've moved everybody. Yes, okay, so let's do this attack. So it's going to be these two units will be attacking there using mobile combat. So the first thing we can do is air support. They will bring in an air support. Actually, they'll bring in, do they have a good one yet? Oh, they have this guy. Forgot about this guy. A 1-6, a very nice airplane there. He'll bring that in, and we will, of course, bring in a plane too. We'll bring in a 1-5 because we want to make sure we get this. Can't spend command points because we already used all our command points, and his HQ is not close enough, and it also has used all its command points. The artillery HQ can only use its command points for the artillery. So let's roll, adding +1 because of mobile combat. Look at that. Looks like the Soviets got theirs. The Germans did not. We know these units can't refuse combat, they have nothing can react to help them out, and they can't declare no retreat because they don't have their HQ and they're not in a strong point or a town or a fortified hex. There's a couple things that let you do no retreat. So he can't do any of those things. He has no artillery to help him out, but we have artillery. So one thing is, this unit, since it's right next to the, adjacent to the unit being attacked, it's automatically coordinated. So we'll go ahead and flip it over and just know that it's automatically going to succeed. The ones we need to test for are going to be for this one and these over here. And what we're going to do is we're just going to make this guy the lead unit for the check, who's got 6, and we'll spend 1 from our Arco. So we need to roll a 6 or less because we got -1 for the Arco, but +1 for being mobile combat. And also, it hasn't happened a whole lot, but this unit's not in woods, right? Yeah. If it was in a woods hex, it also makes it harder to get artillery coordinated, because it's harder to know where to hit, even though I guess, you know, I don't know if that makes a lot of sense, but that's the rule. Okay, so we're looking for 6 or less. All right, we got it. So let's start adding up our values here, since we've got a lot of numbers floating around. This stack I already know is a 9, and I know this one is a 17. Let's actually double check, because I actually don't remember if I counted that properly. So 5, 6, 7, 13. That's actually an 18. Nice. I forgot I swapped out a reduced unit for a full one. So that's 18. That was a 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So we have 27. Now we have 31. Now we have 34. And I guess we didn't need to use all this artillery, but I was going to try to be safe. So now we have 38. So we have 38 attack power. Planes over there, and we'll say 38 to 12, so that's 3 to 1. If we look at some of our odds modifiers, they have +1 for close air support. We get -1 for combined arms bonus, because we have armor and motorized infantry attacking at the same time.
He gets plus one for the village. The ER differential, we're going to be using the motorcycle infantry. So that's 7 to 4. It's a negative 3 for us, so I might put that up here. And now we have to do a combat coordination check. And because the motorcycle infantry is my lead unit, I need to roll a 6 or less because it's plus 1 for mobile combat. Oh, that did not go well. That was a 10. So we don't have combat coordination, so we actually get a plus 2 for a failed combat coordination. Wow, that's a lot of modifiers. So we got, let's see, those, so we got, let's see, that's a plus 2, that's negative 5. So it's all even, I think, right? So we have minus 1 here, but then that's taken out. Yeah, so it's 0 modifier. So a 3 to 1 attack, a 0 modifier, guy's defense in there. Yeah, so here we go. Let's see what we get. All right, 5. I think that should be fairly good. Let's take a look. 3 to 1, a 5 result. Ah, just a defender retreat. Kind of was hoping to do a little bit more there, but that's unfortunate. Okay, so where can he go? And these guys have red box, yeah, so he's gonna have to go like 1. I guess 2. He's gonna be really annoying and go up there. And because I did mobile combat, I actually will advance 2 hexes. I'll go 1. And just to protect my artillery, we'll go 2 up there. Cool, so that gives me actually another little modifier there. Well, that wasn't great. I really kind of wanted to do some damage there, but, you know, that's the way it goes. They used Air Force. It was a clear day. It's kind of where the Soviets are going to start getting advantages because they're going to have more airplanes able to be used as time goes on. Okay, so that was 3rd motorized. So let's see who's next for the Soviets. The 70th. So this is one that we actually will try to do a combined formation, okay? Because we had the 31 or the 21st tanks in reserve, and now we have the 70th. So let's take a moment and let me review combat coordination, and then I'll come back, and then we'll actually discuss it and do the roles that are necessary. So I looked over the rules for combining formations. I called it combat coordination earlier. It's really combining formations, and it's pretty easy. So you remember we passed earlier, we had the 21st tanks activation marker. So now that we've drawn one that we want to combine it with, if we were doing face-to-face, we would have to turn one over, right? Because you're keeping the secret what you draw. Your opponent doesn't necessarily know what you have until you announce it. Pardon me. So what you would do is you declare your intent and turn one of the 2 activation markers face up. And the reason that's important is because if you fail the roll, then the one that you turned face up gets activated. So I don't necessarily want the 21st tanks to go it alone if we don't make this roll. So if I was doing this, I would reveal the 70th and say, I'm going to try to combine formations with the other hidden chit with this. So what we do is we take this, you see it has a number 2 on it. We have to roll a die and we add this number 2. And if we get 8 or higher, then the formations activate together. If we get 7 or lower, then only this one activates. And we can use our leader DRM points for this. I think we will. Actually, we'll keep the 70th in here. I forget where he's at. Where's our leader hiding? Oh, have we not gotten our leader yet? No, we did. He just maybe hasn't come on the board yet. Yeah, he hasn't come on the board yet, which is hilarious, because actually we could use him, but he's not on the board yet. I guess technically he could come on the board with the 70th, but I didn't bring him on earlier. The leader counts as like an army unit, so he doesn't get brought in with any specific formation. He just gets brought in at the start of any formation's activation. You can do that with any army unit that is on the reinforcement schedule. It can come in at any formation of your choosing at the beginning of their formation. So I should have probably brought him out. Wasn't thinking about that. That's okay. So I got to roll a die, and we're going to roll the trusty Soviet red die. No, not enough. So that was a 4. 4 plus 2 is 6, not enough to activate both, so what will happen is we'll just activate the 70th. So our little gamble failed. I wish I had the leader out, but of course the roll just totally whiffed, right? So 70th is here. I was going to show you the whole thing, but since we only need to focus on the 70th, let's just really think about what they're going to do. All right. Because I did not get them to activate together, and even if they did, I was going to take a break anyway and think about how they move. So I'm going to stop again and plan out the 70th attack.
It's taken a little bit of time, but I've thought about what I want to do with the 70th since they failed their combined formation attempt with the 21st tanks. It really would have been very nice to have, because I would have been able to really use all these units here to swarm this guy and make a good attack, because this tank is highly defended. Because this guy's here, I can't sneak my units around. I was going to bring like this guy here and here. This guy was going to stay there, and then this tank was just going to slide down here, and we were going to get like a nice three-way attack on this guy and just start wearing him down with hopefully attrition assaults. Unfortunately, I'm not going to be able to do that, because this unit up here, not only can I not move here and here because the zone of control stops leg infantry, but if I suddenly abandon this line here to strike down here, this panzer grouping will just have easy access that way. I'm already a little worried that I've made it a little too easy to bust through and come up the road, so I'm a little reticent about trying to bring my units down here. And besides, the only thing I could really do is bring this group here. I can't even get to here. So, and this is not, this would only be some like 30 attack factors against 20, 20 something plus. Not to mention they also have artillery here ready to defend. So one thing I did is I was looking up artillery rules because I'm contemplating different attacks, and you know, you always just find little rules that you just kind of missed. And one of them I missed was that you cannot use more than two non-adjacent artilleries for support in one battle. So you may have heard me make offhanded comments that artillery, when it's adjacent to its target, either defender or attacker, can automatically be coordinated and use its strength for that battle. But ones that are not adjacent to the unit, you can only bring in a max of two of them. So I don't think, I think there's only been one battle, I think, in this scenario, and it was up there with the Germans, the third motorized, where I used, I think, like three artillery. Maybe there was one that was next to it, so I may not have broken that rule. Regardless, I've just discovered that as I was looking up artillery. The main reason I was looking up artillery rules is because this group, panzer group up here, is in a marsh, and that not only halves artillery that you fire into that hex, but any support fire they receive is also halved. So that was something I was trying to contemplate, because I think what I'm going to have to do here is I've got to make a move. I can't just be static. I can't just sort of hold back, because they're going to get stronger. I need to be putting pressure on the German position as best I can without abandoning my lines or giving them easy access for the road. So what I think I'm going to do is I'm going to take this stack here. We're going to move this force hex. This stack's going to come over here and hang out in this marsh hex. And then I'm contemplating bringing this infantry unit out of this stack and snaking him up here with this armored car and coming here. So we're going to get a 3-hex surround on this guy. Potentially getting 2-to-1 mobile attack odds. Probably when we settle the artillery fire, it's going to be 3-to-2. Not really advantageous, because the odds are I'll probably lose something. But at the same time, this is a high-value stack. It's going to have to use one of his mechanized infantry to defend, because all he has there is his one lone tank. I mean, he could use that, but it's a pretty valuable unit. So anything I damage here, and that artillery is already spent, anything I damage here is pretty much worth it. And I'm willing to take a step if I can inflict a step loss there. So let's go ahead and start moving these guys. Let's think about what we want to do. So I think this guy's going to stay here. See, it's one of those turns where I would love to just make this an assault combat. And I almost could do that, but I want to use mobile attack on this guy, so I can't use an assault combat turn. Because if I did, I could build a strong point here and start really fortifying my line. That's not really going to happen. So what we're going to do is we're going to declare this a mobile combat round. I have not been saying that very often, but that's what I mean. I don't think I've even done one assault combat in this scenario. That might have happened once. I was hoping to get some with this turn. We'll see if it happens in the future. Okay, so these guys are going to go here. This stack is going to come here. He's going to go there. And what we're going to do is we're going to take this guy out. And just to show that he can make it, it's going to be and one and two and three and, right? So just barely able to make it. And then we're going to slide these guys down the road. Make sure that gets... Can I still get to... Better until we can make it. That one could not. That's okay. Okay. That keeps the artillery coverage on everybody but this unit up here, which is, you know, kind of leaving them in the wind, but that's the way it goes. Okay, so now we're going to do a mobile attack here. So the German units, nothing can combat react to them, or reaction movement, I should say, because nothing is close enough to do that. They could run away. They might try to do that, if only because, you know, they probably would inflict some losses, but, you know, why take the brunt of an attack when you can run away? And I could do a no retreat, but I'm not really afraid of no retreat for the German unit. If I am forced to retreat, it's, you know, what, a couple hexes, and I can just zoom back up. And I'm not worried about giving up ground. So I think I will try to do a combat refusal, because if you do a combat refusal and fail, then you don't qualify for reaction movement, and you don't qualify for a no retreat. Since I don't care about no retreat, I'm actually okay with doing this role. So we'll take our lead unit as that guy, because they're all sixes. There's nothing higher than a six rating there. So we're going to roll for that, see if we can beat that. We do not. It's a 10, so he's going to have to stay in battle. All right, so let's think about what we're going to do here. First we say, do we want to bring any close air support in? Well, yeah, as the... attacking Soviets, I'm definitely going to bring in some of my airplanes, and I've got a decent one in the reserve here, so we'll bring that. The Germans have only one airplane left, and they will also bring that in. I'm not going to spend command points to get this airplane in, because I think it's more important for me to pass my combat coordination check, and that's going to be tough enough with attacking from three hexes, because that gives you a plus two modifier to that. It's going to be tough to do. So I think we're just going to straight up just roll these, and I think the Germans don't really care about getting their plane in. I think they're feeling sort of okay, so they're not going to spend command points on this. Although they could, they have tons of excess command points. Yeah. Hey, look at that. Oh, no. Because it's plus one, that's what the Soviets rolled, so because of mobile combat, they don't get their plane. Neither do the Germans. Well, that would have been actually kind of helpful. But, you know, case or not. So now we do artillery support, and I think the Germans will throw in some artillery because, you know, why not? So I think they're going to throw in, we'll just throw in these two fours. I'm going to flip those to that. So we got to roll a 6 or better, or 6 or less with a plus. So here's the modifiers now, so let's take a look. Only because this guy sent in a Marsh Hex and a Woods Hex, and I don't think we've fired on a guy in a Woods Hex before. Alright, so for artillery checks, the DRMs, we have command point modifiers, the one guy, command points, and plus 2 if it can... contains, Defender Hex contains woods. So we get a plus 2 for that, plus 1 for mobile combat. So we will actually use 2 command points for this, and we'll use this guy's command points. So the modifiers, we just took 2 for here, and that's going to negate the woods cost, and then we just get our plus 1 for mobile combat. So we need to get a 6 or less. Well, we got a 10. And unfortunately, that means nothing happens. That means we totally whiffed on the artillery roll, because with the we didn't have any modifiers. We just, you know, had the plus 1, so this becomes an 11. So all that artillery we just fired did nothing. It gave us 0 points. So I'm also committed to using artillery. I should have probably committed both sides at the same time, right? Because he commits he's going to use something, I commit, then we roll, because it's really unfair if I'm like, oh, you didn't make your roll. I don't necessarily need to do that. No, I think we're just going to play it cool. There's only one unit that can reach it, and it is... 1, 2, 3, 4... Yeah, it's the 6 unit. So we'll go ahead and flip him over. also going to be very tough because he gets the +2/+1, and I'm not using anything, so I got to roll extremely low for me to get anything really good out of this. Yeah, that didn't work. And in fact, the modified roll becomes a 10 because it was a 7, so actually nothing happens because it was +2 for woods, +1 for mobile, so I don't get anything out of that either. The Soviet artillery totally whiffs. Apparently it's just hard to hit guys in a swamp that are hiding in a forested swamp. Okay, so we've done that. We've got no die roll modifiers. The artillery is not good. Now we just need to do a combat coordination check. So I'm doing a mobile attack from 3 hexes. I'm going to select my lead unit as one of my 5.5.4s. We'll go ahead and make it out of the stack. I think I have a 5.5.4 in there. It has a ER rating of 6. So I am going to spend command points on that. He's over here. I'm going to spend 2 because the modifiers for this are +1 for being mobile and +2 because I'm attacking from 3 or more hexes. So with the command rule or command points I spent here, I only have a modifier of +1 now to my roll. So let's see if we can get this together. No, man, such high rolls. 9, 10. So we failed our combat coordination. That's not great for us. So +2 for failed combat coordination. All right, let's calculate some of these attack and defense. So we know that he has 18 defense. And I am attacking with, I had it sort of calculated, but now I've been talking a lot. Okay, so we got 7 there. We have 17 there, so 7 and 17 is what, 24? And then we have 29, 35, 36, and then 39 points. So that's 2 to 1. He has no defensive terrain in terms of combat. I don't think marshes don't do anything for combat. Woods don't do anything for combat, so he doesn't get any defensive terrain bonuses. He gets, since we're using a 6 unit and he's using a 6 unit, we don't even get a ER benefit. So it's just +2. Do we get a combined? We do get a, no. Do we? Let me see. Where's my cheat sheet? -1 if the attacking force has at least 1 armored unit and 1 armored units of motorcycle, motorized infantry, or recon. Oh, I have motorized infantry or engineer. I have an engineer. It's not motorized. I don't think there's, is there such a thing as motorized engineers? I do actually have an engineering force. So I think that does qualify me for the combined arms bonus. That helps. So we got a -1 total. Oh, I'm sorry, +1. What am I thinking? +1 total. 2 to 1 attack, +1. Let's hope we get some nice. Oh, yeah. All right, we got a 1. This is so big. This is the best roll we could have gotten. So 1 + 1 = 2 on a 2 to 1 attack. Finally, an attack goes well for the Soviets. That was kind of risky. So what do we got? We got a 2. Yeah, defender 1, retreat. Big, big time. Almost had a defender 2 retreat. That would have been the 1 result, but we didn't get that. So, this guy flips. That's big time. And he has to retreat. He's going to go 1, 2. We're going to try to protect our artillery. Even though that's just the way that goes. And we can advance after combat now, which is kind of crazy. I can only advance 1 space because most of these guys are flag infantry. They're not red box units. And I think I will go ahead and move him up to there, because that way it gives me a little bit more ability to swing down here or even get further out there. Okay, so that was actually a pretty good attack. I was a little worried that was going to go very badly for the old Soviets, but man, they pushed them back. They moved the line forward a little bit. We're starting to get that little push down effect. Hopefully when we get the 21st tanks involved, which we can see there's units down here, hopefully they're going to be able to come up here and do cut threats or even try strike at this artillery. They won't be able to quite make it, but I think I can get close enough that maybe next turn I can start being a real serious cut threat. Even though we know the 8th Panzer is going to go next because they're the only Soviet chip or German chip left, let's take a look at some of the issues they have before I jump into their turn. One is I got this sort of pressure mounting here, and it's significant now. They're getting pushed back. They lost a step. Not great. If we look down here, though, keep in mind that 8th Panzer now has to go first, and 183rd is not moved. So they're going to take these units and sort of stretch them out along the road to make sure that the 183rd can't cut supply this turn, simply by crossing here. Like, this guy could go here and cut supply right away, you know? So because they're not going to be able to react to anything the 183rd does, I'm going to have to get proactive and really think about how I'm going to stretch my forces out to keep them not from getting attacked, because these aren't necessarily real strong units on their own. I mean, grouped together, they're fairly defensive, but, you know, there's going to be a lot of struggle to think of how we're going to react to the 8th Panzer, because we may have to siphon more forces up here just to make sure we keep this from being cut, because next turn the Germans, or the Soviets, receive the, what is it, the 180th will come in from the south down here where the 183rd came in, and they're a sizable unit as well, and so there's going to be a lot more trouble happening up here. It's going to be really interesting, going to be really interesting turns. Okay, so that was the 70th, that was the 70th, that was a pretty good activation for them. So we automatically know, wrong cup. I mean, we automatically know the 8th Panzer is going to come up. So I'm going to take a look at the 8th Panzer because I've got to really decide how I'm going to allocate their forces and if I'm going to counterattack or what I want to do. That's going to take me a little time. So let me put that together, and when we come back, it'll be the last activation for the German forces in the 15 a.m. turn. It's really funny. At the beginning of this turn, I really thought the Germans had the upper hand, and I was thinking, man, they're making good progress on Soltsy, making good progress on Utrecht to the north. You know, I've got some problems to deal with, but, you know, this isn't half bad. I've got a really good defensive stack. I've got some offensive stacks. And then last turn happened, or the last phase happened, with a 70th making a very aggressive attack this way and knocking back my Panzer stack. It's put me in, and it's hard to, it's one of those things that you sort of begin to realize, I just lost one step, and it has totally deflated my entire idea of what I had accomplished, which is really funny, because position changes everything. So let's take a look here. Granted, I only lost one step here, but I was pushed back. So what did that do? Now the 70th has got this kind of line bulging here. They're going to have free access next turn. Granted, they may not go for a while. They may not get the chip pull they want. The 8th has a lot of time to react. But let's say they gain the initiative and go first. Well, next turn, they have plenty of time to sweep down here and get a bigger envelopment here or potentially attack these units. And regardless of how the chip pulls come out, I don't want to abandon Soltsy if I can. If I keep holding it, I get bonus victory points, I believe, from the 16 a.m. turn onward. I need to check that. I can't believe I just said that out loud, and I could have looked it up. Hold on. Yeah, after 16 a.m., for each turn the Germans hold the victory point hex in Soltsy, they get plus 3 VPs, which is supposed to tell you how difficult it should be for you to hold it, because that's a pretty juicy prize. And that victory hex is here. So I not only have to worry about these forces, because now this is quite powerful, and I don't have anything but here to deal with this. And if we don't, you know, can't forget about the fact that the 21st Tanks is right down there, or the fact that there's the 183rd ready to interdict the roads. And this is maybe the bigger problem that's looming, is that I have limited ability to stop these guys who have not activated yet. I gotta say, the Soviets have gotten really favorable chip pulls this turn. I really didn't think they were gonna get such good pulls, and this turn started developing. I was disappointed with the 21st Tanks and giving up, you know, initiative. But at the same time, keeping these guys in reserve at the very end and waiting until the 8th Panzer's already activated, this is good for them because they're in great position. This guy can jump here and here and cut the road. He can come up here and jump there and cut the road. He can go here and cut the road. These forces are a little less able to cut in multiple places, but where they can cut, it's further down here. So if this guy comes up here and these guys are over here, well, suddenly you have two very, you know, distant flashpoints you got to deal with, or else supply is totally cut off. Although, as you remember in this game, supply can be cut off for a turn, you're on emergency supply, but if you don't deal with the problem by then you're totally cut off. And you're going to face big time problems then until you can get your supply back in order. Okay, there we go. issue about using books. Stacking with books there. All right. So let's return to our issue here and exactly think about how we want to deal with the situation. So my thought is I want to defend. I really can't attack because this stack is actually greatly weakened. It is now only a 3, 7, 13? Just a 13 stack without that artillery. And it can't even tackle this. I thought about maybe moving up here and attacking this stack, which is just that armored car and an infantry unit. Just 7 points, but I can't even get 2-1 at mobile attack odds. And worse off, I don't want to put myself in a position where if the 21st Tanks activates, which I know they will soon, that they can swing over here and do an assault combat, or even just come punish me for getting out of place, because this stack now is pretty powerful. It's a 6, 12, 17 on its own right. So I don't want to put myself in a position where I end up getting smacked by those tanks. So this turn is going to be purely defensive. It's going to be an assault turn. I know, I haven't done an assault turn except for maybe once before, but we're going to do it now. Why am I doing an assault turn? Big reason, I can build a strong point here in this hex because I have motorized infantry in this hex, and I really do feel like this is the strong point. They're going to have to really focus on knocking these guys out. It's going to be tougher for them to assault this hex because of a few reasons. One, I control this town hex, but two, this river is here, and the only way you can attack without losing half of your attack strength is by attacking this hex across the bridge. You just lose so much attack power going across rivers that aren't bridged that it's almost foolhardy and foolish to do so. So even though I can't fortify this hex as much, it still can be pretty well defended as long as this one holds out. So what I'm going to do is take an assault turn, and the main reason is I want to build a strong point here. So let's go ahead and construct one. That. Now, the other thing, though, is if I'm using an assault turn, I only get half my MA. So I only get, what is that? These are all sixes. So I just get, oh, that's a five. So I get 2.5, and that's going to be perfect, because what I'm going to do is I'm going to go 1, 2, and they're going to hang out in Bolshoi Zabrovye, mainly because that's going to give them the ability to protect this artillery from any kind of attacks this way. And it also kind of allows us to sort of put zones of control here and here so that these guys can't do a complete wraparound and try to get here. It's not perfect, but it's going to be an improvised defense. It's going to give me some flexibility to counterattack. Yeah, so the thing is I really probably should be pulling these units back to help deal with this crisis, because this is the next thing I need to think about. But honestly, until I know where they're moving, I don't really want to commit too many forces, because I still will have... They could cut it this turn, and that means I would have one turn to get rid of them before, like, so I'd have 2 activations. It's not a lot, but I think I'm just going to have to deal with it. What I could try to do is move these forces so that I can try to prevent the most painful cutoffs from occurring. So I could move some of these tanks up to, say, Dubrova or Rybitsy. Oh, Rybitsy. It's probably U. This is a Y. It's probably an U. So it's Rybitsy, Dubrova. If I go to Rubitsy, this will keep him from taking this hex because he can easily go here, but that won't stop him from going here. But if he comes up here and his other guys go here, like I said, the distance is quite great for me to traverse. Oh, sorry, that's off camera. I also don't want to give them just easy targets of opportunity because, you know, these aren't really powerful stacks, but, you know, this one's a 10 stack. I think it's a 4, 8, oh no, 11, 12. That's a 12 stack. I mean, this is just... I mean, that's just a 5, so he could easily get 2-1 odds there. Ugh, it's just one of those tough things where I'm like, what am I going to do here? I mean, this guy's just really a 3. Yeah, oof, this is bad news in a way. So I think what we're going to do is we're just going to group our forces into 2 different points. We're going to take... What is this through? That's 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay. These guys can all stack. I think I'm going to go down here and stack in this X. So we're going to go and 1 and 2. And then we're going to go and 1 and 2 and. The reason we're going to do that is because these units can maybe come up here, but I'll still be in supply if they still, because they won't be able to cut past this road, or at least I don't think they'll be able to get to that hex. And these guys are going to go up to and.
to Dubrova. So that's going to be and one, and two. Actually, I'm going to go to Rubitsi. They're going to do that so they can try to keep them from coming up here too easily. Now, it's going to allow them easily cut up here. They can go in the middle of the road. I can't stop them from cutting the road. That's kind of the thing. I can minimize it. I can group up here and just hope that they go to the edges. But instead, I'm going to go to the edges and just hope they go to the middle or try to figure it out. Because at least if they go in the middle, these forces will stay in supply. Which is not great, but they, you know, they can be very helpful. And I can begin to sort of crush them in the middle, right? So I'd rather have them where I can attack them from both sides as opposed to having to split my forces and attack different points. I'd rather come in the middle and attack them there. That may actually be terrible advice. That may be terrible planning, but that's what I'm going to do to make that turn chill. And if we go look at these guys, I think I'm pretty happy with how everybody's moved here. The only thing is, I don't know if I want to move this guy. He is sort of vulnerable. I think what I'm going to do is, because I have plenty of artillery here to support a lot of things, although maybe not as much as I really want. But he's got an artillery piece, and there's... Okay, this guy's going to come down here. He's going to go and one, and two, and three. We're going to put him there. That should keep him out of... Yeah, that should keep him out of any ability to get killed. Oh, you didn't even see that. I'm so sorry. I brought him over there. My bad. Sorry, guys. And gals, if anybody's watching. Alright, so I put him up here. Well, we'll just have to see if that holds out. It's not optimal, but it's the best I think I can do, and it also gives me the ability to get that strong point in place, which is the most important thing. It's going to let me hopefully hold Soltsy a little longer, a little better. We'll see. Okay, so that's it for the German chits. So let's see what kind of... there's three, actually, Soviet chits available. There's 21st tanks still up. And we drew the 202. So we'll go ahead and do the 202. Because since the Germans aren't moving anymore, there's really not any pressure for me to do this in any specific order. And really the 202 is easy because it's just this guy here. And because he's reduced and kind of ridiculous, we're going to have him just go protect Bolot. So he's going to go and one, and two, and three, and four, and that's what he's going to do. He's just going to keep the odd or errant German unit from just coming down there and scoring easy victory points. These guys are going to come up and reinforce, I believe, this point, because I was afraid of the breakout by the 3rd Motorized up there over in Utrecht. But I feel like that's been contained, but I still want to get units up there because I'm still worried. We don't want to have 3rd Motorized just running around the countryside rampant. So, what do we got here? We got some anti-tank unit. We got an armored car. We have motorcycle infantry, another motorcycle infantry, another motorcycle infantry, our leader, and an NKVD unit. So I think what we're going to do is we're going to take... these guys all stack. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, yeah. They all stack together. And their lowest movement is 6. So what we're going to do is we're just going to go and 1 and 2. Sorry, flipping around the camera. 2 and 3 and 4 and 5 and 6. We'll go here. The leader, I think we're going to send down to the main front and go and 1 and 2. We'll keep him here with these guys. I should have brought him out earlier. It would have helped with some of my checks I made, especially the combining formations check. Ugh, didn't happen. That's the way the cookie crumbles. And we'll take this NKVD unit, which is over here. And they're only special because they can automatically enact no retreats as well. You don't have to have a HQ or a protective point. An NKVD unit can do it as well. I think he's better off guarding this road down here. So we're going to go and 1, and 2, and 3, and 4. I'm going to put him here, and if this is going to be his fallback point. And if we get really pushed back, that's where we're going to go, although I really doubt that's going to happen. Okay, so that's a 202. That was a fairly easy activation. That leaves only one chit left in the cup. It's the 183rd. So we have the 183rd and the 21st tanks left. I think I'm going to go ahead and think about how I want to move both of them. And then when I come back, we'll actually decide how I want these guys to get in the game, because they're actually in a really potent position that could put a lot of pressure on the soft underbelly here. I think I've said that twice. That's kind of lame. I should not say that anymore when I'm talking about this game. And I also need to decide how these guys are going to respond, given how the 8th Panzer has positioned themselves, how best I want them to enact their cutting, because I do want them to cut the road. Obviously, that's the main reason they exist. And next turn, they're going to be reinforced by even more troops, so it's time to put the pressure on. It's time to bring the pocket to a close. So when I come back, we'll take a look and see what the 183rd is going to do, and also the 21st tanks. I'll just move them both at the same time. So yeah, be right back. Okay, I've thought about what I want to do with the 183rd, and I have lots of options. Like I said, the 8th Panzer couldn't stop me from cutting the road. They just tried to stop what they might have thought was the worst scenario or possible one for them to deal with. Indeed, I am going to be concentrating my forces in the middle here, but I think I've done it in a way that's going to make it difficult to dislodge. So here's what I'm going to do. These guys are just going to slip across the river here. 1-2, and they're going to hide in Vubetska. Man, I really hope that's not in the east end, but it's Vubetska, we'll call it that. That lets them cut the road here because they're zone of control. It also gives them the ability to be in a village. Now, the thing is, they're vulnerable to attack from this direction, because if they have the village, that's +1. If people cross the stream to attack them, it's +1 as well. But if even one unit attacking them in a group can get across and attack them from a non-stream position, they lose that +1 defensive ability. You know, that's kind of maybe harsh, and who knows how realistic that is, but you know, it makes sense in this kind of scale, I think, for this game. But the way I've solved that is, bingo, 1, 2, 3, 4, because infantry do not count woods hexes, they're just clear to them. So it's 1, 2, 1 for crossing, 1 here, 3, 4. Now, I'm cutting off the hexes here and here, and here. I've also made it so that you cannot assault this hex, or at least attack it, without having to cross a stream until you knock out this unit first. And then what we'll do is we'll bring this infantry, or this, well, technically the artillery unit's in a pretty good position, but I don't want it to be too far away. And the other thing is I don't necessarily want to cover up this space. I might want it to have it as a retreat path because it's rough. This is one of the few rough spots on the map. And rough forces assaults and prohibits mobile combat if you attack through that hex side. I think, though, it might not even matter if it's here. I need to look at the rules, though, about terrain and what it has an effect. If it's just a hex side or if it is the roughest terrain in the hex kind of rule. Regardless, the artillery here, I'm kind of babbling. What should the artillery do? I want them to be close, but, you know, I don't want them to get sniped. That just might prove very difficult to prevent. Unless... they have a range of 5. 1, 2, 3. And they need to be in command of 4 hexes with that. I think I'm just going to put them here. They could totally just be totally killed. They might just die. The other problem, of course, is by crossing the stream, I've now officially put these guys out of supply. It's something they're just going to have to deal with. That's sort of the nature of the game. Unless I used an assault turn to build a bridging unit anywhere here, which I could do next turn. We'll see. I really should have thought about where I was going to put this artillery unit. Sorry, I hate to waste time on the camera debating a unit movement like this. You know what? They're going to be mobile attacked. It's just going to leave this artillery totally vulnerable. Okay. I'm just going to go there. It's the furthest point away you can stay in command range and also still provide support to any of those guys. So yeah, we'll do that. Okay, so since that was the 183rd's turn, the only activation marker left is the 21st tanks. So now we have to decide what we want to do with them, and that includes not only those units there, but that guy up there. So I'm going to take another little break because this is going to require just a smidgen of thought as well, and come right back. On two sides of a very
weak, but, you know, capable pincer. I don't know, maybe kind of strong. We'll see. Are the 21st tanks. We have this grouping down here, and then we have this sort of lone grouping up here of two tanks and a motorized infantry, probably their most capable units, except for some down here are pretty capable as well. The question is how to use them most effectively, given that I don't want them to get sniped next turn, but they are kind of going where they know no one's going to retaliate this turn. And here's what I've decided to do. With this guy, the question is, do I leave him hanging, or do I take advantage of the fact that he's slow moving, but he's a very powerful force, and if I can do the combined formations next turn, or get a chance to do so, he could be the spearhead of a very powerful assault. And if I'm able to win initiative and perhaps get the activate any formation marker, this could lead to a very nice chain of events. It's not guaranteed, it's not even probable, likely, but it's something you got to shoot for if you're a Soviet player. And you got to take risks, and I've been taking a lot of risks, and at first I thought it was kind of killing the Soviets, but it's been paying off a little bit here. That attack here was a risk, but it paid off. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually move them down to here. It's going to be and one and two. And we'll do that pretty easily. They can still react move if they get attacked. It's still pretty unlikely. I mean, they did last turn. That was pretty wild, passing the five while the German units did not pass their reaction or combat refusal. I keep saying reaction, but it's really called combat refusal. So we're going to take advantage of that. We're going to put them there because that lets them get this kind of position where, you know, given the right opportunity, and as you see, we're going to move the Southern Force, they could have a nice little sweeping maneuver down here. Now, you can't just put a hanging nice VP target up here without having a counter threat to make it seem like you can't just go for it. And that's where the Southern Force comes in. So the key was I want to put them in a position where next turn they can also cut the road. Because I hope the 183rd is going to be able to hold out. I've got them in a good position. But I want to make it so that even if they can't hold out, I have another threat that's going to further strain what the 8th Panzer can do. This one won't necessarily pull the forces out as far, but I think it will provide an effective means of putting additional pressure on already scant German resources. So what we're going to do here is we're going to take these five units, we're going to group just out of here, and here's how we're going to do it. We're going to go and one, oh, sorry, and one and two and, this is three, four, and he's going to move there. This guy can do the same thing, but it's going to take all of his movement because he's only just one half space back. So he groups there. This infantry unit is going to go... Ah, there he is. And one, and two, three, four. Sort of the nice sneaky ability. Using forests. Forests are a great little conduit because it slows everything else in the game down but leg infantry. And if you can use them effectively, forests are infantry's kind of best friend. Unfortunately, this tank is the slowest of the lot, and it's going to go and one, two, three, and that's as far as it can go. And it really is going to have a tough time doing anything really effective. And we'll bring this artillery unit along as well. It'll be and one, and... two and three and, so we'll just keep it here with the tank. The goal is that these forces could then next turn have some options. This especially can cut up here, these guys can go there, he can go 1, 2, 3, 4 and then cut off this X, this X, this X. He can go 1, 2, 3, 4, cut off these X's. These forces are a little bit more mobile because they can go and then kind of jump off in various places, or go and then jump off here. So the idea is that basically I'm putting even more pressure, getting aggressive. This move is kind of paying off. We'll see. It's looking kind of rough, going to be up here for the Germans. One thing to remember, though, is that they hold the airport hex, or this air hex. And by holding it, they can actually supply two hexes worth of units, not artillery, but just regular units, and keep them in supply. It's something I didn't really aggressively use in my last playthrough. I thought I was under pressure there, but man, I'm getting a lot of pressure here as well. So in the last game, I had the 237 kind of come down this way, but I had the 3rd Motorized fully focus their attention up there at the cost of the fact that the 183rd has now gotten aggressive, which they weren't as aggressive in my last game. Okay, so that concludes all the activations. So let's take a look at the board in general.
Oh, sorry, light. It's nighttime. Sorry about that.
So now you see we got units kind of scattered all along the road again. Mainly because the 183rd is cutting up here. We got the grouping by the 21st tanks there. Soltsy is beginning to be fortified, as well as this strong point up here. The 3rd Motorized is also scattered but beginning to concentrate, although they have issues with this sort of 12 stack that's going to be preoccupying their attention. And that's going to give these units precious time to perhaps get out of disruption and build more strong points, as well as allow members of the 202 to build their strong points there and get fortified, sort of the rear victory point hexes. Still a lot of turns left. After this, we'll have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 turns, so just halfway at the point. Next turn, look at the reinforcements. The first SS units will be coming into play. They only get a limited amount of forces, but it is something additional, and they get additional activation marker, which will help. And then, of course, the Soviets get these forces. They're going to pop in on the southern border along, helping out the 183rd's efforts to cut the road. So, yeah. 8th Panzer is going to be a world of hurt. Next turn, all these units are going to be in emergency supply. So will these units. Everything else, though, I think will be okay and in supply and good to go. I might need to check on these. Some of these might be out. I'll look as well. And that looks good to go. So as we end this turn and move into the halfway point, definitely developing into a very interesting battle.